and welcome. You're watching NDTV. I'm Rishika Barua. India is seeing a second wave of coronavirus cases. After the decline in cases that we saw over the last 2 months, what's really causing the cases to rise once again? Are large crowds, social gatherings, weddings, offices reopening, is all of this solely to blame? Or is there a rapidly spreading mutant strain of the coronavirus that we need to be worried about? To answer all your questions about this surge in cases, we have with us the director of the All India Institute of Medical Sciences, Dr. Randeep Guleria, joining us on the broadcast. Thanks so much, Dr. Guleria, for sparing your time and being with us. The second wave of COVID-19 is what we're staring at the moment. Why are India's cases rising again?
So I think there are multiple factors why this is happening. And one, of course, like mentioned, is that there is a loss of COVID-appropriate behavior. A lot of people feel that the pandemic is over because vaccines are here, and therefore they really don't need to wear their mask or have physical distancing or even wash hands. And we are seeing large crowds happening. People are not wearing masks. And many of these crowded events can become super spreading events. We're seeing marriages where people are really not having COVID-appropriate behavior. This can lead to huge spread in number of cases. Even if one person out there is COVID-positive, he can spread the infection to others. Then the other issue, we become a little lax in the basic principle of testing, tracking, and isolating people that we were doing 6 months ago. Any person who is positive, a very aggressive tracking of the close contacts, they were isolated, they were quarantined or tested using a rapid antigen test, and then they were admitted or kept in isolation if they turned out to be positive. That has also not been done in various areas, and therefore the infection has started spreading a lot. Third point, which you mentioned, that we already know that there is the virus itself is changing, and there are mutations are emerging, and many of them are more infectious. So the environment created is ideal for such a mutant to really spread rapidly. And that seems to be happening in many states now.
All right. Dr. Guleria, we couldn't really understand the last bit of your answer, so I'll urge you to repeat that. But we're going to try and fix that audio line with you, because as Dr. Guleria said, there is a disproportionate rise in cases in certain states. Maharashtra, for instance, at the moment is accounting for over 61% of cases in India. There are theatres, auditoriums, cinema halls, offices, all of that now that has been asked to operate at 50% capacity in Maharashtra. Even the state of Punjab, for instance, is seeing a huge spike in COVID-19 cases. Educational institutions have been closed in the state of Punjab till the 31st of March. Cinema halls in Punjab have also been asked to operate at 50% capacity, and only 100 people will be allowed inside malls at any given point in time. As far as private government hospitals are concerned, in Punjab, they've been asked now to carry out vaccinations 7 days a week and 8 hours daily till the 31st of March. Are some of these measures enough? That's, of course, the big question. Even in Gujarat, there are a whole host of restrictions that have, in fact, been put in place. The question, therefore, Dr. Guleria, if you can hear me, and I think that's the big worry at the moment, is that there is a sudden spurt of cases in certain states. Maharashtra, for instance, being the worst state, we're seeing a huge rise in Punjab as well. If COVID-appropriate behavior were the sole factor to blame, then why would cases be rising in fits and starts in certain pockets?
So like I said, there are multiple factors. One, of course, is the lack of COVID-appropriate behavior. But along with that, you must also understand that we also have other factors which come into play. Crowded areas, mutants circulating in that area, and the fact that you may have a super spreading event in that area which will lead to a sudden surge in pocket. In other areas, you may have a crowd, you may not have a positivity. Remember, when we had our cases 2 weeks ago, number was very low. So it was likely in certain areas you have that much of infection and the cases did not rise in that area. But this could rapidly change over the next few days if they are not very vigilant, because the virus will rapidly to other parts of the country also.
Right, but 400 cases of UK, South Africa, Brazil strains in India as per the health ministry estimates. Will the second wave of COVID-19, as we've seen in several other countries that have these variants, will there be a bigger surge in cases as far as the second wave is concerned? What's your reading of the numbers?
So I think we will surge in the number of cases. It may not be as big as the previous wave, but a lot depends on how we sort of move forward. And we have two or three weapons. One is, of course, the COVID-appropriate behavior. The second is a vaccine. And the third is aggressive testing, tracking, and isolation. So if you're able to vaccinate a large number of people quickly, especially the high-risk group and those with comorbidity, if you're able to have good COVID-appropriate behavior, you may not see such a large peak, and it may actually come down as far as the number of cases is concerned.
All right. Will the second wave of COVID-19 cause less severe illness? That's the other big question that a lot of people are asking.
So that is something that we need to keep in mind. But if you currently look at the data that is emerging, it seems that the mortality is also rising as the number of cases are increasing. In the initial part, it was felt that with the cases that we are seeing currently are milder. And it was felt that we may be seeing milder in cases because I think it was causing more infection in people who are moving around, who are active. And those were the younger generation in which the cases are milder. But we know that they would carry the infection to their homes where they have elderly living or they have people with comorbidities. And that is what is happening, that now we're seeing an increase in the number of cases. Also, hospitalization has increased. Therefore, it is a cause of concern. And I think we will see a similar pattern that the cases will also rise and we may have an increase in mortality also over a period of time.
All right, so there is no evidence to say that the second wave would be less deadly than the first, or even the opposite could be true. Now, speaking of mutant strains, Dr. Guerrero, Covishield, which is the Oxford AstraZeneca vaccine, is known to be not effective against the South African strain. South Africa returned doses of the Serum Institute vaccine back to India. Is this a setback? Because many of our viewers have actually asked us this question, that why are cases rising again despite the fact that we are vaccinating so many people on a daily basis?
So we're vaccinating a large number of people, but as a percentage of people being vaccinated, it is still very low. Remember, we are a very large country and our population is 1.3 billion. Even if we vaccinate 1 or 2 crore, in absolute percentage, it's only 1% or a little over 1%. So therefore, we still have a long way to go, and that's why while we do the vaccination in a phased manner, considering the number of doses that we have, COVID-appropriate behavior and the testing, tracking, isolation becomes very important. Also, coming to the Covishield vaccine, now there is data which suggests from South Africa, there is a paper published recently in the New England Journal of Medicine, which actually suggests that the vaccine efficacy comes down to only 10 to 20% as far as the South African strain is concerned. However, one must look at that paper critically because it had very few events. The number of people who got COVID after vaccination was low, but most of them got it with the South African variant, and it did tend to suggest that the vaccine efficacy comes down. So there is something that needs to be done, and this is something that we need to look at as we go along because this is just one variant. Over a period of time, other variants which may develop what we call immune escape phenomena may occur. And therefore, the vaccines as we move along may have to be tweaked to really become more effective against the variants.
No, you've said that in the past as well, that vaccines may need to be tweaked in the future to respond to variant strains. But speaking of today, of right now, the government with its own admission has not given us the breakup, but we know that there are over 400 cases of these mutant strains. Is it an immediate cause of concern that the Oxford AstraZeneca vaccine is not effective against the South African strain? We still don't know anything about the efficacy of the Bharat Biotech vaccine.
So currently, it's not a cause of concern because we don't have enough robust data to suggest that the vaccine is not working. But like I said, we need to be vigilant because we need to have a very regular monitoring of the gene sequencing of the virus circulating in our country. We need to see how does that correlate with the clinical outcome. Is that leading to more people getting infection even if they've been vaccinated? Is it leading to more severe disease? Is it leading to the immune escape phenomena? So I would say that as we go along the vaccination process, we need to really have robust research and surveillance to be able to answer these questions because this is an evolving thing. What I'm saying today may not be relevant 2 weeks or 1 month from now as the virus mutates and changes.
Absolutely, yes. Dr. Guleria, the other big question, and this is again, become a point of debate between experts here in India, is there a homegrown strain that is driving up India's numbers? There are expert doctors, say from Maharashtra, who've talked about, a local strain in Amravati, or in certain pockets of Maharashtra where we've seen a spike in cases. So is there a homegrown strain? Do we know anything about it?
So there may be variants in India which are, have happened, which is quite likely. If it's a variant of clinical significance in terms of causing more severe disease, causing more infection, or having an immune escape phenomena, that is a cause of concern. We know that the virus will undergo mutation and will have variants developing. That is why we have a consortium set up in India of 10 centers which are taking 5% of all positive cases and also taking cases, samples from areas where outbreaks are happening to look for any variants. And that is not only looking for the three variants that we're talking of, the South African, Brazilian and the UK variant, but any new variant which emerges and trying to correlate that with clinical significance. I think it's very important because as has happened in various other parts of the world, we will see some variants occurring in our country also.
All right. You know, there are certain districts, according to the health ministry, that are seeing a very disproportionate rise in cases, you know, 300% to 500% spike in certain remote districts of the country. What explains this?
So if we are looking at our zero surveillance data, you will realize that there are many areas in our country which have very little immunity from the point of view of people having got infection in the past. There are especially rural areas and small areas where we have individuals where the person of persons who have actually got infection is very low. That means the majority of the population is susceptible. In such a situation, if you have one individual who is asymptomatic and he comes in that area, he can lead to a large number of people getting infected there. And from no infection, you could have a large cluster of infection happening because of a large susceptible population. Whereas in a city where there has already been a large number of people infected and there is, I won't say herd immunity, but large number of people already having some degree of immunity, the number of cases may not rise that much as compared to in an area where there was no infection in the past.
Right. And, you know, the chances of reinfection with a new strain or the chances of reinfection per se, given the fact that the pandemic has been around for a year now, what more do we know about reinfection?
So this is something that we need to look at because as you rightly said, there are people who've had the infection almost 8, 9 or 10 months ago,
yes,
or longer, and their immunity may have waned with time and therefore one doesn't know whether they have now sufficient antibodies to really protect themselves from getting reinfection or whether the virus itself has mutated to some extent that they are not protected as much as one would like them to be. Therefore, I think that is the reason why we keep emphasizing about COVID appropriate behavior because even if you've had COVID infection in the past, especially if it's been many months, you should not really assume that you cannot get the COVID again and stop wearing your mask or stop having physical distancing and things like that. There are cases that have been reported and therefore we need to be vigilant. We just need to look at what happened in Brazil. Brazil's thought they had achieved herd immunity. They had 70% of people who had got infected.
Yes.
Yet with the new variant, they had a huge surge in the number of cases, especially in the city of Manaus. And I think that is why we need to keep that in mind because despite all of them having got the infection, they still got a large number of reinfections. So we must learn from what is happening in other countries and really be very vigilant.
Well, absolutely. And Brazil, I think, is an extremely worrying situation right now. The healthcare infrastructure in Brazil is completely stretched out. But Dr. Guleria, speaking of international countries, based on what we've seen in other Western countries, for instance, there are many people who are now asking, and many of them actually asking because this is a question stemming from fear, is another lockdown the only way forward to contain the kind of rapid spread that we are seeing here in India? Because cases are rising and rising very quickly if you look at what's happened in the last week.
So I think we need to be vigilant. Lockdown alone is not going to be enough. Like I said, we have to develop containment areas, containment zones where we're seeing a cluster. After all, this is happening only in some parts of the country and we're not seeing a large number of cases in other parts. But in those areas where this is happening, there has to be an aggressive strategy. You have to really do aggressive testing. You have to really isolate individuals. You have to develop containment zones so that people out there who have got exposed to the infection do not travel to other areas and carry the infection with them. And thereby develop micro containment zone, have aggressive action taken and aggressive COVID appropriate behavior. So what we were doing 6-7 months ago, we need to do that. Otherwise, we will again have a huge number of cases all over the country.
Well, we are going to slip into a very short break, but on the other side, I'll ask you whether the strategies that have been implemented right now to stop the second wave in its tracks, whether those strategies are enough and whether they are actually working. We'll ask you that question on the other side of a short break. Stay with us. Welcome back. Dr. Randeep Guleria is live with us. Dr. Guleria, do weekend lockdowns, extended night curfews really work in containing the spread of COVID?
Not very much. They will not really work because you need to break the chain of transmission. And just by having a lockdown over 24 hours will not really be effective in breaking the chain of transmission, because you really need to have sufficient time, which is equivalent to the incubation period, to prevent the infection from going from one individual to the other. Therefore, it may not have that much of an effect as more sustained action would have.
Also, workplaces and cinema halls at 50% capacity, a lot of states have done this, temporarily closed down schools and colleges. Are these measures enough, given how rapidly the cases are rising?
So I think any area which has a potential of being a crowded area with people not having COVID appropriate behavior and which can be a super spreading sort of an event should be avoided. So if we have even cinema halls which are open and there are chances that they could be crowded or any other function like that, it's better right now to really stop them rather than regretting later on. So better to have aggressive action because these are non-essential events and can actually be stopped for some time.
All right. So one should perhaps be expecting some kind of a order to that effect. But temporary suspension of AstraZeneca across countries in Europe, do you believe that this has increased vaccine hesitancy against the Covishield here in India as well? We have a lot of viewers who've written in asking about the safety of the vaccine.
I can understand that, and that's possibly related to the fact that this has created a little bit of confusion in everyone's mind, because it was first put on hold by many countries in Europe and then they said it's all right. Mm-hmm. People are always suspicious when some things like that happen. But I think it's important to understand that when we are rolling out a vaccine on such a large scale, all regulatory authorities want to be extra cautious. So if there's any doubt, they would rather err towards the side of being more cautious rather than being a little reckless. And that is why this was done.
Right.
But what is really being shown is that what they were looking at was increased incidence of blood clots. But it did not really, there was no correlation with what we call the cause and effect. It seemed more coincidental and it was not related to the vaccine. And therefore, I think I'd like to reassure everyone that there's hardly any data or there's no data which really supports
right.
any chance of blood clots occurring due to AstraZeneca.
Well, I think that reassurance is much needed. Dr. Guleria, a lot of our viewers have asked this question. Can a mix of two different vaccines of COVID be given? Can you get one vaccine as your first dose and another vaccine as your second dose?
Currently, it is not recommended, but there are trials going on. There are two trials going on that I am aware of in UK, where they're looking at AstraZeneca as the first vaccine and Sputnik as the second, or combining AstraZeneca with the Pfizer vaccine as first and second dose, with the hope that since you're giving two different platforms, it may lead to a better immune response. We're looking forward to that data, but that until then, we should continue with the same dose.
All right. Very last question, and I'm completely out of time. Why is India not opening up vaccines for all adults? This is every second question that we've been asked by our viewers is this, by the way.
So I would love if we could open up vaccines for everyone and especially adults, but we must understand that we should have enough doses to do that. And if we look at the adult population of our country over 18 years, it's about 97 crores. It's just less than a billion people. And we will need 2 billion doses if we were to vaccinate the entire adult population in our country, because we have to do it twice.
Right.
2 doses are required. We don't have that many doses. So it has to be done in a phased manner. And we have to look at saving lives. That's why the first group is the high-risk group. Over a period of time, everyone will get their vaccination.
Okay, so we just have to wait. We will get our vaccines. And it's unfortunate, though, that in the category of people who can be vaccinated, also there's an average of 6.5% vaccine wastage in the country. So if you are eligible, like Dr. Guleria said, the vaccine's absolutely safe. You must go out and absolutely get it. Thank you so much, Dr. Guleri, for sparing your time and being with us on the show today. Thanks for watching.
Thank you.